So sound is on, yeah. Yeah, so welcome to the Get Old, Go Slow, Write Code. So I was counting my JFocus t-shirts the other day, and according to those, this should be my 7th JFocus. 3rd time as a speaker, so yeah. Normally I'm a consultant at Citeris here in Stockholm, so this should be my like home conference. And the home conference, that's actually like the scariest place to speak at. Because, you know, the audience, it's filled with friends. So if you like start rant about something, you will find that person like sitting on the 5th row. And you can't lie either, because there is always someone who can like verify or kill your story. So with that said, this will be a completely true talk. But beware of those like rotten tomatoes coming down from the 5th row. So, get old, go slow. It's like 2 separate topics, actually. I had 2 separate talks ideas. One is about how it is to get old as a developer, getting slow, and the like average age of software developers. And the other one is like about speed. I have for quite a long time had some issues with a focus on speed when it comes to software development. So I started digging into those two, for me, different subjects, but I found some kind of like similarities between them. So suddenly that like 2 separate talks idea merged into one. And when sketching on this talk, I wanted to do it like interactive, especially the age part. So please have some kind of device ready in a few minutes. I will go with an online poll for that. But let's start with the aging stuff. And I start by quoting myself from the like talk description. Turning old as a developer is hard. It is hard to stay relevant, hard to keep up with the competition of newcomers, and hard to know all of those new frameworks, tools, languages, and practices. So like 10, maybe 15 years ago, I was working at a quite big transportation company here in Stockholm. And we were like 10 developers maybe, working on their public website. And we were sitting in this quite big room. But in that room, there were also like 2 odd fishes, 2 grumpy old men. And one of them actually like coughed so loud. So everyone was like taking shelter each time. It was like insane. And he did it like every 15 minutes. So it was like, you know, Sneezy, that the dwarf in Snow White, the Disney version. So it was like coding, like hiding, coding, incoming. It was like, it was crazy. But nevertheless, those 2 old men, they were working on some kind of like other system. I think it was a maintenance system for some kind of like vehicles. And it had this like, you know, old fashioned UI taken directly from like war games. Black background, big blue capital letters. That was it. And I think it was developed in Fortran. At least it couldn't have been C, because both of them lacked, you know, this like big C developer beard. I think it was Fortran. Nevertheless, one day, those 2 men, they were gone. Their system had been replaced. They were like relics from an ancient time. And in some kind of way, those 2 men, they have been like the mental picture for me, how it is to get old as a developer. Getting old, not just like physical, but also in techniques. But let's get back to the like main question. What is old? So let's pick up those devices, and I forward that question to you. So please, use a QR code or enter the etc.ch/v5, capital M, I think that's capital actually is important, X, so etc.ch/v5, capital M, X. I will give you a few more seconds. Are we ready to go? So this is actually a like warm-up question. We had these discussions yesterday at the evening, so I'm quite happy actually that Jar Jar is the one who's leaving, but a little bit upset about people killing Yoda. But nevertheless, let's go to the real one. So, this should be an easy one. And since this is a developer conference, I assume that most of us has at least a developer background. So please try to answer those questions from some kind of like developer perspective. This one should be quite easy, but there are coming more. So what is your age? And it actually seems like we are quite old in this room. Could be the topic, I don't know. So 40% of us are actually about my age. That's interesting. So let's turn to the next one. Do you consider yourself being old? Yes, no, or are you kidding me? I guess that's the same as no. I think we're done there. Third and final question for now. So what do you consider being old? Is it like being in the 20s, 30s, 40s, 50 or over? Or you're that kind of guy like, that thinks that it's like your age plus one. Like everyone who's older than you are actually old, but you will never get there yourself. That could be interesting to dig into. But I guess most of us say that age is mental, not physical. So like I said, this audience seemed to be quite a lot older, actually, than the average age of a software developer. Because according to the latest Stack Overflow survey, we had like, I think it's 90,000 respondent, the average age of a software developer is 28. India are the lowest, which have about 26. Australia are the oldest ones, with a little bit over 32, and the rest of us are like in between there. And when I read this, I thought that 28, that's quite young. Could this be true? So I started like at least trying to get some kind of perspective of this. So I compared us to other professions. And of course, this is a little bit like comparing apples and oranges, means some professions are like, you know, wider and others are more narrow. And also the data I found, it's not like perfect. So some is like from surveys, others are true statistics, etc. So don't take this number for like an exact truth. But I'm definitely sure that it is like accurate enough to like compare it to us developers. So I started looking at teachers and what's the average age of a teacher. Well, for you who know your hitchhiking, it's actually the same as the meaning of the life. So it's 42. So they beat us with like almost 15 years. That's a huge gap. I continue looking at the doctors, medical doctors, assuming that they should probably be even a little bit older. And no surprise there, they are averaging 51. And what's, I don't know if I should call it funny, but at least like 40% of the medical doctors are at least twice as old as the average software developer. And that's quite crazy, actually. Continuing, looking at the project managers, and this would be an interesting one, I think, because we usually work in more or less the same companies with the same projects. I assume we have like the same level of education, etc. So should we be about the same age? Or? But they are actually the same as teachers, averaging about 42. And I kept on looking to a few more like similar professions, and I couldn't find anything that was even close to the age of software developers. I thought it might be like the level of education. So I continued looking at a few other professions that don't demand those years at universities, starting with taxi drivers. And that was actually a little bit of a surprise for me, because they are even older than teachers, averaging 47. So I really needed to go lower. So I went to the bar and looked at the bartenders. And now we're getting closer, but still, they are almost six and a half years older than us, averaging about 34. And how about their colleagues, the dishwashers? Well, that's a bummer. They are actually about the same age as the bartenders, also averaging 34. Now I was starting to get like a little bit frustrated, because I really wanted to find something by myself, not just like looking at the top of the statistics. I wanted to find something that was at least a little bit close to the age of software developers. And then I remember this tweet I saw. How about Minecraft players? And we're actually beating those with 4 years. They are averaging 24. But being a Minecraft player, that's not really a true profession, right? At least not for most of us. So they have this like hordes of 10-year-old kiddies who I assume averaging this, lowering this average quite a lot. So I needed to look a little bit more. And then I came up to it. I got it. You can always trust the US military, right? So what's the average age of a US military? Well, that's not really a profession, more of an employer. So these numbers are actually like everything from like five-star generals to like pilots, truck drivers, and cannon fodder. And they are averaging 27. So we are actually beating those with 1 year. And also, people doing sports as a profession. For instance, the average age of European professional football players are actually a little bit over 26. So there are a few more professions that are like younger than us. And when cheating, looking at those statistics, I found a few more, like lifeguards. But still, I would say that being a software developer is definitely one of the youngest professions in the world. And if I take like level of education under consideration, I would actually say that we're probably the youngest. But age is one thing. What's actually more important to me is how long do we tend to like stay as developers? So when do we quit? Moving over to you again. How many years of experience as a developer do you have? Is it below 2, 2 to 5, 6 to 10, 11 to 15, 15 to 20, or even more than 20 years? By the way, did I say that I was 44? I think I'm like in the average age in this room. We'll get a few more answers, so I give it a few seconds more. Next question. What was the age of the best developer you have ever worked with? So was that person below 20, 21 to 30, 31 to 40, 41 to 50, over 50, or was it 44? That's a magic number. So I guess I know at least 1.8% of this audience. That's nice. Final question for now. So how many years will you continue being a developer if you take a wild guess? So will this be your final year? Or is it 1 to 2 years, 3 to 5, 6 to 10, more than 10 years? Or will you actually like code till you die? And I would say that that I code till I die. That will actually like could be like this is my final year, but let's hope not. So I would say once again that this audience is actually quite a lot older than the average, because the average age or the average number of years to stay as a software developer is 8. And that's quite short, I think. So what's the reason of that? Are people like using being a software developer as some kind of like bouncing pad towards other professions? Or are we scaring them away? Let's find out. What do you think? What do you think will make you quit as a developer? Do you think you will be burned out? Or will you get some kind of like promotion, changing role? Or will you code until retirement? Or like losing the spark? It is not fun to work anymore. It's not fun to code. Or do you think it has something to do with the aging? You're getting old, getting slow. Quite a few who hope that they will win at the lottery. And a few others as well. So promotion, changing role, that stands out. And it's actually so, when both reading surveys and when I have like talked to colleagues who used to be developers, they are three things that stands out quite a lot. And the first one is losing the spark. It is not fun to code anymore. And the second one is getting a promotion or in some way climbing that company hierarchy. And the third one is that it's hard to keep up, that you're getting old, you're getting slow. So let's elaborate a little bit on those three, starting with losing the spark. And for me, losing the spark, that's, well, it's a quite sad reason to quit, actually. But it's also a very valid one, I would say. Because if you don't have like the passion for coding, you shouldn't have it as a profession either. So I would say, if you're not in the mood for coding anymore, then you should definitely move on. But how about the second reason? Getting a promotion, climbing the hierarchy. That was actually like the most popular thing here. And I would say that if it is in combination of like losing the spark, you don't think it's fun to code anymore, then I would say do that. You should follow like your passion. But if not, I would say that I actually once stepped into this trap myself. So I was quite flattered and also surprised when I was offered to be the head of development at the .NET place. And I'm sorry to say that I said yes. And I'm also sorry to say that it was like so boring. It felt like a total waste of my tech expertise. So instead I was sitting on those budget meetings or having discussions regarding like resource allocation. Or I had to fight that CAB meeting, you know, the change advisory board, where I had to explain why this change that my developers did in the mobile app could not make airplanes to fall down from the sky. That might sound like a bad joke, but that's actually true. I actually had to explain to this group of quite, what I think, smart people, like the CTO and the head architect, why this change in the mobile app could not make airplanes to crash. That's crazy. So was I good at my job? Well, I think that my teams liked me. And I was quite good like guarding them from the insanity of company administration, but I was definitely not as good from many other point of views. And I think we all have seen this, right? Yes, because someone is a great developer, that doesn't mean that the same person will be a great manager or a good project leader or even an okay boss. I would say that the opposite is probably just as common. And there is actually a term regarding this, stated in the late 60s by two men called Lawrence J. Peter and Raymond Hull. And it's called the Peter Principle. And the Peter Principle states that the person who is competent at their job will earn promotion to more senior position, which require different skills. So if the promoted person lacks the skill for the new role, then they will be incompetent at the new level, and so they will not be promoted again. So people will be promoted until they reach their level of incompetence. And there they will stay, being incompetent, forever. So we have these companies which are stuck in what... Did we lose the... There it is. Which are stuck in what we are called the Peter's corollary, that in time, every post tends to be occupied by an employee who is incompetent to carry out his duties. So we have those companies where more or less everyone is incompetent at their work. Of course, this is a little bit satirical, maybe. I don't know. But I think it has like some kind of truth in it as well. And there we have the like expected software developer career path, where we are expected to start as a software developer, and then we should move on, probably aiming for team lead, and after that advancing to project leader, until we finally, a few of us, reach the nirvana, being a manager. That's what people call the software developer life cycle. For me, that's crazy. That's more or less like moving people from being competent to being incompetent. And it is actually that there is a course on Pluralsight how to go from a developer to a manager. And let me read out this description a little bit. So there comes a time in every developer's career when they have to decide what direction they want to go in. And for many, this may mean becoming a manager of a software development team. For me, we definitely need to address this. We need to make some kind of like career path for developers who want to still keep on coding, instead of moving them from being competent to being incompetent. So are there any managers seeing this? Where's the camera there? But could you please stop transforming your like 10x developers into 0.4x managers? Instead, give them like free hands, a decent salary, reward them continuously, and let them keep on doing what they do best, coding. Wow. So that's what I'm trying to say. If you have the passion to code, please stay on. But how about the third reason to quit? Getting old, getting slow, having it hard to keep up. So is it like a problem to be old as a developer? Maybe Mr. Zuckerberg were right. Young people are just smarter. I don't know. I would say that he is wrong. I might be biased here, but I mean, for instance, Newton, he was 44 when he published the Principia. And Röntgen was the same age when he found out the X-ray. And if you take a look at the like Nobel Prize winners these days, they look definitely more like American president candidates than software developers. So I would definitely say that it does not have to do with like intelligence, at least. But I wouldn't say that we are not like dinosaurs ready for extinction. But how about the other part? Are we getting slow? I don't care, actually, because to me, being slow is good. That is actually something we should aim for. So in one of my other talks that I have, I quickly mentioned that I think that we need to slow down when it comes to software development. And I started to like read up a little bit on this, and I found out that way smarter people than me had more or less the same idea. For instance, J.B. Rainsberger, who says that worried that TDD will slow down your programmer, don't. They probably need slowing down. And the same guy, once more, sooner, not faster, slow down to avoid making rash commitments. And another one here from Lemmy, you know that Turkish guy who found the Mac OS root bug a few years ago? So he states that going fast without control could be the biggest enemy of software development. And I actually think that too many people mix up like speed or being fast with rushing. We developers, we behave too much like Usain Bolt, running as fast as we can. You know Usain Bolt, the fastest man on earth, on 100 meters. But what we tend to forget is that being a software developer is not the same as a 100 meter dash. So we run as fast as we can for 100 meters, but then we reach the goal, and we rush for 100 more meters, and 100 more, over and over and over again. So I believe we should not be like Usain Bolt. We should be a long distance runner. We should find the sustainable pace. That guy on the picture there is from Spain, from a little village south of Pamplona, and he's called Ricardo Abad. In 2010, 1st of October, he started to run for charity. So he was promised that some companies would give him like $1 for charity for each kilometer that he ran. So he ran a marathon that day. And then he ran a marathon more the other day. And he kept on going for 607 consecutive days. That's almost 2 years. He ran one marathon each day. At the same time, he was working full time at the factory. That's amazing. So that's what I think we should aim for, finding the sustainable pace so we can keep on doing what we are doing for years after years. So why are we doing this kind of rushing? Of course, there could be a lot of different ideas, but to me, deadlines are definitely one of the key things. For me, deadlines, they are like usually poison. It's some kind of like random date that someone guesstimated a long time ago, and then it's more or less automatically becomes the truth. Something that we need to aim for, something that we need to like rush to reach. But I was actually in a team that was doing this, what I think, the right way once. So at that time, I was a system architect at the Swedish tech agency. So we were working with a like login and authentication of users for the public e-services. And for you who don't know the Swedish tech agency, I recognize a few over here that definitely do. But they have this kind of like hard fixed deadline once a year, or at least they had it when I was there, because everything at the Swedish tax agency like circles around the yearly income tax declaration. So they have this deadline in the beginning of March, and you won't release anything after that. Then it will be like a code freeze. So during those weeks, like 5-6 weeks, there are approximately 6.5 million unique Swedish user using their services. That could be a quite good deadline, I don't know. But what we needed to do was to replace an old, obsolete solution with a new one. And this was a quite big work. So we needed new hardware We needed new software from the supplier, and of course, we needed quite a lot of coding as well. But after a while, we needed to take a decision, because that deadline in March, it felt tough. It was starting to feel hard. So should we like rush? Should we work overtime? Should we try to like cheat with the quality to build a working but crappy solution? Or should we more or less wait for another year and aim for the next year? And at that case, we actually took what I still think is one of the best decisions that I have been taken in all my career. We actually decided to wait. We said that, no, we will not rush. We will take the time that it needs, so let's aim for the next year. So sure, we lost quite a lot of prestige, but still, we could build a solution with good quality that was easy to maintain and that they could use for years to come, a solution that we could be proud of. But I'm sorry to say that this is actually one of the few occasions that I have actually seen this. The usual behavior is often like, but let's move that deadline a week more, so let's work overtime. Oh, you didn't reach that either, so let's move that deadline another week. For me, that's just like creating bad software. So let's pick up those phones again. So how often do you feel stressed about deadlines? Is it all the time, often, almost never, or never? I'm quite glad that more than half of us seems to do this quite good. Moving on to the next one in 3, 2, 1. So, how often do you like cut corners, cheat with quality? Do you do it all the time, or often, or almost never, or actually never? Once again, quite good numbers that I would say could be with aging. You'll get wiser when you get old. The third and final question for now. Why do you cut corners when you do it? Is it like pressure from management or from the team or from yourself? Or is like quality more like more boring and unnecessary? Or what's quality? Or do you have some other kind of reason? Management, it looks like. Let's go talk to them. Another quite, for me, big reason why we are rushing are actually like the lean and the startup movement, where we are told that the only thing that matters is to deliver, to be the first on the market. We need speed. We need to be faster. And sure, that might be important to a few companies. But for most of us, I would say that it doesn't matter, not if you like looking at what you the speed you gain by cheating with quality. I took a quick look at 3 quite big developer places in Stockholm and checked one of their like latest features that they have added. Spotify, for instance, do you think that people will stop listening to Spotify music just because a share playlist with a QR code is late for a week or two? Or Minecraft, will people stop playing Minecraft just because the B update must wait for the next release? Or do you think that the like mortgage loans customers will change bank move their loans just because they can't download the interest rates as a PDF file for another month. I promise you that won't happen. But I can also be quite sure that those customers, they will definitely leave you if you start building a crappy solution that you can't change at all in a few years' time. So go with the quality. And also, another, what I think, like, big reason that people are rushing are actually all those, like, bad implementations in the name of Agile. I mean, just listen to the word sprint. What does that imply? Let's rush as hard as you can for 2 weeks, then come back tomorrow and we start another 2 weeks rush. That's crazy. But actually, if you take a look at the Agile Manifesto, it actually states that Agile processes promote sustainable development. The sponsors, developers, and users should be able to maintain a constant pace indefinitely. So what I say is don't aim for that speed, aim for the quality. And therefore, it doesn't matter if you're getting a little bit old, if you're getting a little bit slow, because it does not come down to who is like the fastest typer on the keyboard, or who knows all of those like new techniques, or who can understand everything without asking those stupid questions. What it comes down to is the quality of the code. Uncle Bob, Robert C. Martin, he claims that if your software is getting harder and harder to develop, you are doing something wrong. And to me, that's exactly what happens if we rush. The software will be harder and harder to develop until we reach that state that we need to like start the big rewrite. Who has not been there? Like, you're building something new, but you haven't really got the time to do it properly. So you cut a few corners, you cheat a little bit with the tests, with the best intentions to add those things later, because there are always more time just around the corner, right? Just finish this like rushing thing now. We will have more time later. But believe me, you won't get more time later. That bad code, that will live on forever until it bites you, until you can't change that software at all. So then, the same people will start building the same application once more, but they really don't have the time to do it properly, right? So they start cheating a little bit with quality, and there we go again. There's a word for this. It's called waste. It can kill your company. And Martin Fowler, he's also more or less on the same track. The fundamental role of internal quality is that it lowers the cost of future change. But there is some extra effort required to write good software, which does impose some cost in the short term. So what he says is more or less the same. It will cost you a little bit more to build things right, to build things slow, to build it with quality, but in the long run, you will definitely be quicker. But he also states that developers find poor quality code significantly slows them down within a few weeks. So that means that's not much of a runway, right? Where we are actually gaining on rushing, on cheating with quality. Because just after a few weeks, that software will be harder to develop and you will not be faster anymore. So let me... No, I'm sorry, I'm cheating. I thought it was a new poll there. But no. So what I'm talking about, like slowing down, what do I mean with slowing down? I believe that we should like slow down in a lot of different areas. For instance, We should slow down and take time to practice. We should take time to improve our quality. Usually when I see this is something that we developers do on our free time, on the spare time, evenings, weekends. But I also say that you should have the right to improve your quality on the like regular working hours, because this should be a like mixed responsibility between the company and the developers, because both gain of it. And I also claim that you should slow down so you can tweak your process, so you can eliminate that waste. For instance, use those retrospectives and make sure to have a good outcome. And make sure that you take the time to improve it, to improve those like fixes for that bad process. And you should slow down and take the time to plan. I would say that we usually do this the least when we need it the most, when we are hurrying, when we are rushing. So please take it a little bit slower. Think about what you are doing and plan ahead. For instance, use those sprint plannings and the daily stand-up, or whatever you are calling them. For me, the most important question of the stand-up, what should I do today? That's like planning a little bit ahead, tweaking that process all the time. And you should slow down and take the time to refactor, improve your code, make it easier to maintain. Remember the Boy Scout rule. Always leave your campground a little bit cleaner than you found it. And you should slow down to build with quality. What do I mean by building with quality? For instance, write those tests. Don't cheat with it. Using pull requests, that's also a way where we like slowing down the process in favor of improved quality. Mob programming, pair programming are a little bit the same. It might be slower in the short run, but you will definitely be quicker in the long run. So let's a final quote to see if you're like agreeing with me. So you will now go home and like take the course, developer to manager. Or will you go down and start slowing down? Or will you rush a little bit harder? Or will you promise yourself to keep on coding? Or will you play Minecraft to like raise the average age? Or should you just learn Fortran? Everyone's not like you. Are we having any more votes? So, this was actually the first time I gave this talk. So I would be glad to have some kind of feedback. Should I do it again, or should I like put it in the dustbin? So please, just, was this an excellent talk, a good talk? It was okay, but not more. Or was it more like peeling onions in a submarine? Or was it even worse? Was it like listening to Justin Bieber? Thank you. That was everything I would like to say. You have been a great audience. Let's keep in touch. So you can reach me at the Twitter, LinkedIn, email. Just come up to me, grab me at the fika. Thank you.